Good day, everyone. This is the second recording for Chapter 1, and we're going to talk today about the scientific method. There are generally four or five steps that you can use in describing the scientific method, and the reason that science uses this method is that it helps us use knowledge from testing experiments and to make predictions about the data that we have. And this is very important in the development of scientific theories. In the process of the scientific method, one of the first steps is to come up with a question that needs answered. And then you can perform tests, experiments, make observations, and eventually, with all of that information, what might develop refer to as a hypothesis, which is simply a tentative explanation of initial interpretation of data. Upon further testing, data collection, interpretation of data, if your hypothesis holds true, then this hypothesis, which was tentative, may be elevated to a theory. Now, a theory is a well-tested and widely accepted viewpoint in the scientific community. This is a little flow chart showing the process in the scientific method. So we raise the question, what are we trying to solve? You collect scientific data that relates to the question. A hypothesis is developed. You analyze your data. If the results support the hypothesis, you can share with the scientific community. If the results do not support the hypothesis, then you go back and try again. And so this process is ongoing. If we look at the Earth, it is a dynamic planet, and it has separate but interacting parts. So what we want to look at here is the different spheres on our planet. So showing here, we have the hydrosphere. That's the water part of our planet. Also within the hydrosphere, some refer to the cryosphere as a subsphere within the hydrosphere, which is the frozen water portion of our planet. We have the atmosphere. That's the gaseous envelope surrounding our planet. The geosphere is the solid Earth, and the biosphere is the plant and animal life. Now, all of these spheres are independent, separate, but they are interacting. Here is a diagram showing our hydrosphere, and it's our hydrosphere. Most of our hydrosphere consists of salt water, 97.5%, and fresh water, only 2.5%. Now, if we look just at this 2.5% of fresh water and spread it out, most of that is locked up in the glaciers, so that's not usable fresh water for us. The next amount, highest amount of fresh water is in groundwater, and that's the water that exists in pore spaces and fractures in the rock and sediment within the Earth. If you look at the streams, lakes, soil moisture, atmosphere, and the water that's associated with those, it's 0.03%. Although that's what we see, and we think that it seems like there's much more than that. This is showing the atmosphere and the different layers of the atmosphere. Here is our biosphere. And in looking at a tropical rainforest, very complex ecosystem, equivalent to a coral reef, except not underwater. And so coral reefs, a very complex ecosystem as well. And they're unique, complex, and home to about 25% of all marine organisms. All right, so they are the ocean equivalent of a rainforest, is how they describe it. So let's talk about what a system is. A system is a group of interacting parts that form a complex whole. And in geology, we have something we refer to as earth system science. And that is an approach to studying Earth as a system of interacting parts. And so this is an interdisciplinary approach. If we talk about our solar system, and initially we can say the universe began with the Big Bang, but the question is, what began, what formed, what theory do we use to describe how our solar system formed? So we use the nebular theory, and it says that the bodies of our solar system evolved from an enormous rotating cloud called a solar nebula. So everything within our solar system is the same age. Our solar system, all of its planets, meteors, comets, formed at the same time from this rotating cloud of dust and gases. So the solar nebula consisted of hydrogen, helium, and dust. And with time, the nebula began to contract and rotate and assume a flat disk shape with a proto-sun, the early beginnings of our sun. The inner planets formed from metallic and rocky substances, and then our outer planets formed from fragments of ice, water, CO2, and others. So if we remember what our inner planets are, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, and then we have the asteroid belt, and then our outer planets consist of Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Here's an image of the initial formation of our solar system of just cloud of dust and gases, and you can see the progression into more and more organized solar system with time.